move to the next decade. It's our considered opinion that we will work with you. We would use your cases and case studies to help other people understand that it's possible to reform not only Kenya, but the many countries in the sub-region that we are working. That sometimes the problems that bedevil us as Kenyans are also facing other countries. And if we are able to find a solution to the challenge in Kenya, it's very possible for us to help our neighbors also move forward. But also there are times when they have better solutions than us. So it's not that just Kenyans would be the ones leading the process elsewhere, but there are great things that have happened in Tanzania, even as they go through their very many challenges, and we need to learn from them. There are great things that have happened in Rwanda that we need to learn from them, even as we also help them to embrace the bigger good governance and human rights discourse. So feel welcome, because I will be taking another session. What I want to do is to welcome Mr. John Gashi. In London, they call him Gashi. John Gashi is a veteran journalist. He used to be foreign news editor in Nation Media Group for many years and has been part of the movement supporting freedom of expression in the sub-region for a long time. He recruited me into the human rights world reluctantly, but I have now stayed there longer to even begin being seen to be. Sometimes people refer to Article 19 as Henry Maina, and I say, no, there are many people who preceded me. And so John would welcome you to make some brief remarks, then we can get to other presentation. Karibu.
But just to say, ladies and gentlemen, we are very, very, very happy that you did make time to come and join us today. And we are very, very proud that we have survived this long. And I will tell you why. Some 10 years ago, when Article 19 was being established, we had had some interesting engagement and run-ins with the certain political forces in this country at that time. And we went to apply for registration because prior to us coming down here, there were some very senior people, and some of them, if I mention them, you will recall, we had senior counsel, Piroz Norji, and Itobi Manyara, and indeed, even the current Attorney General was also affiliated with us. Surprise, surprise, ladies and gentlemen. And indeed, we had people like Professor Makau, people like William Mutunga, people like Maina Kiai, and a lot of others. And we wanted to register out here to be able to function. And we got a little bit of a problem when we went to the registry and asked, and we were asked to provide, what is Article 19? So the first thing they asked, what is that? And you can imagine trying to explain to a lot of people that Article 19 is simply the right to express yourself, just to say who you are and what it is that you feel you want to say. And I remember we were asked, so who gave you the right to say? And indeed, we tried very hard to convince them that we meant no bad, we meant no good to this country. So after a long while with intelligence and security trying to find out who are these people, we were summoned, a lot of us were summoned to the then the current NGO, and we were grieved and trying to find out what the hell were we doing here? What is it that we wanted to do? were we not satisfied that there were a lot of other members of the single, what they call evil society. But we persevered and we got registered. Now, this is 10 years down the road, and at that particular time, we were only three of us. One, Roxana Pilar, she's a British citizen. Another one was Sissy Fadoka, an American citizen. And I, and we were only operating in Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. But unfortunately, we didn't have enough funds at that particular time, so we confined ourselves to only Kenya just for Show the Flag, but mostly Sudan, then, just before it broke into South Sudan and Sudan as it is. Now, what has happened over those 10 years? I can tell you for sure there have been a lot of developments. Article 19 currently is operating in about 14 countries. The Secretariat is now grown. It's 10 plus, and I'm sure they are still recruiting. And the funding, the areas of activity has grown tremendously, and our reach has really grown. Having said that, there is one man, perhaps, who, with his secretary, has had a very good impact. That is in Uganda. In Uganda, he's called the Rapper Rouser for a very good reason, because he's been fighting for space. He's very eloquent, and he has managed to move Article 19 to where it is today. Perhaps Paddy here would confirm that possibly within the Article 19 international family, the fastest growing regional affiliate, that is autonomous, is the East Africa one. I am hoping that Paddy would bear witness to that. Indeed, since 2014, we have expanded our board. And our board currently includes a lady from Rwanda, very senior, another lady from Uganda, very senior, and they will be introduced later on when they arrive. We have George Kegoro, I'm sure you all know, regional entity. Having said that too, I must recognize the support and passion of London. The presence of Paddy here is really an indication of what the international secretary and indeed the international board feels about what Article 19 is an Article 19. So, ladies and gentlemen, perhaps you might want to ask, what is it that we have made, or what our successes have been? I would say one of our best successes so far, at least the one that we feel we can grab a little bit, possibly in Kenya, is that we've managed after a long, long struggle to have criminal libel decriminalized in Kenya, at least for the journalists. For me as a journalist, and for a lot of others who have been here, that was a major, major milestone. Over the years, we have trained over 400 journalists on safety and protection in the region. And we are currently engaged in a lot of other similar activities in the region, in Rwanda, in Uganda, in Tanzania, in Somalia, and in South Sudan. I would not want to say a lot of other things because due to safety and security concerns, we are also operating in areas that possibly are close to a lot of people. I would say we are engaged in our region in places like Djibouti, places like Eritrea, places like Ethiopia, and places like Burundi. But that is a story for another day.
Article 19 uses interventions of setting standards. So we have documents like Johannesburg principles that speak on freedom of expression and national security. We have lately launched a policy document on right to privacy and freedom of expression, what is the proper balance. We have many other principles like free flow principles, the connection of right to water and right to information, a healthy knowledge, the connection between right to health and access to information. So beginning to show that right to information is not an abstract right. It's related to all other rights, and you can't say I'm guaranteeing right to health if you are not doing much on right to information. So thinking through those, mostly you would see that we were ahead of time, because our strategy 2016-2022 and recently is even before the SDGs were adopted. So beginning to think what is sustainable development when you think about health, when you think about open, just and fair societies, when you think about education, how do we relate that to access to information? And so in this situation, Article 19 on that pillar of transparency works, one, to push for enactment of laws as an intervention and a critical area. And as John pointed out, by the time Article 19 was registered in 2007, we only had one country in the sub-region having access to information laws. Today, we are happy to say of the 14 countries, we have 7 more countries, so 8 countries in the sub-region now have access to information laws. The challenge is, are they implementing those laws? So Kenya is one of those that have a law, and Fred also was referring to, they have the oversight mechanism. Tanzania has equally passed a law, South Sudan, Rwanda, and others. So in thinking through that, we need to be able to see our organization works in what is not a very compartmentalized kind of area, but our theory of engagement, our theory of change, is that there are things we will do at international level, there are things we will do at local level, and we keep the flow of that kind of engagement going. So an example is that we identify criminal deformation to be a problem at the local level, and we started processes of thinking through how may we deal with criminal deformation, with sedition, with insult laws that remain in our penal code and criminalize expression. And as we think through those, we keep monitoring what was happening. So I've given an example that in the earlier years, the organization supported Charles Onyango Hope and Andrew Mwenda in Uganda to challenge sedition charges. Then in Kenya, you see that over time, we get now to pick a case of Jacqueline Okuta and Kurgat to support them so that we can be able to deal with criminal deformation at a local level. But as we're doing that, we were aware that there were regional and international processes that were speaking to that as a concern. So Article 19 remained, for instance, we knew that we have these many cases at the base of the pyramid. You know, I'm just using Kenya as an example. So if we were to give you the cases in all the countries, you'll notice there are too many. You know, you have people like Sided, Nkajibibi in Rwanda, jailed or defamation. And so there are many cases in each of these countries.
And our argument was, what do we do at a national level, at a local level, to those individuals so that they stop facing those challenges? But what do we do at national, regional, and international level so that there is a process that begins to clearly demarcate what states' obligations are? So at an international level, you see that at that time we worked with Frank Lalu, then a special rapporteur of the UN on freedom of expression, and currently David Kaye, both who have ended up saying criminal defamation is a disproportionate sanction and limitation on freedom of expression. So once they've done that, at a regional level, we were engaging with the African court through a case of Konate versus Burkina Faso. So again, you will see Konate versus Burkina Faso. Konate is a journalist in Burkina Faso. We know that Kenya has not signed a protocol that allows Kenyans to approach the court, but Burkina Faso had signed. So it gives us an opportunity to help a Burkinabe journalist to come to the African court in Arusha and challenge criminal defamation in Burkina Faso. But once the African court arrives at a decision that criminal defamation is a violation of the African Charter, then that becomes our working decision on the continent. And when now we take up Jacqueline's case or Kurgan's case, in our courts, we first argue that the African court has already said this. You need to be able to follow it. So that is the connection that we are making about flow of impact and testimony. So there is one that is going up, Kurgat and Jacqueline's cases going up, but there is a decision of Frank Laru, David Kaye at the international level UN, or Pansy Tlakula, the African special rapporteur, coming down to our courts and using that as an example. So the thinking is that there are activities we lead on at an international level. And an example has been that Article 19 led a process of having a special mandate holder on Eritrea at the UN level. So a process that began here, thinking through Eritrea is a difficult country, what do we do? Helping, working across our state delegation until there was a resolution to create a special mandate on Eritrea. Then supporting that special mandate to begin doing work that helps Eritrean journalists in the team. So that speaks to some of those themes. I've spoken about the theme of transparency, but also now the theme of media. How do we think through regulation? Because everyone in all these countries seeks to regulate the media. Everyone, sometimes police officers, senior government officers, people of means in any society, the first thing they all want to do is to regulate media. And sometimes they do this outside what the law means. And so how do we think through regulatory processes? How do we also ensure that the media is professional enough to be able to engage? But also how do we ensure that licensing procedures allow divergent media to exist? You notice there's a colleague who said there he's joined one of the new radio stations of Media Monks. Increasingly, there is a problem in Kenya. So you have 80 to 90% of all media outlets owned by four entities. So we are saying we have very many TV stations, we have very many radio stations, but the truth is they are only owned by four entities. So it's not rare for you to notice that Henry Maina appears on Citizen and he is known to be partisan in some way. Then that evening he appears on another two TV stations. So there are many TV stations, but the voice we are hearing is one. Then there is a problem there. How do we begin to move that process forward? The third area and theme that we are engaging in is on digital affairs. And you've noticed many
of colleagues in here introduced themselves as social media influencers. And when we began this discussion, at one point when the country was discussing and passing Kenya Information Communication Amendment Act in 2013, I kept telling people, this law has provisions that are problematic. And they told me, Helen, you are just a skeptic. You know, you never see a good thing anytime. I even told meetings of women journalists that there are provisions here that are going to be used to incriminate women journalists. Why? Because they don't have platforms in regular media. And whenever they are going to feel offended, they will run to social media to say certain things. And people will use that to punish them. But they told me, no, Henry, we need something that can punish everyone. Come 2016, we already had like 50 cases on one provision of Kenya Information and Communication Amendment. Most of those 50 cases were about young women who had just expressed themselves online, sometimes disagreeing with their bosses or people they had relationships with. And yet, the people, instead of responding to that concern, they chose to use a criminal justice system to sort out a social problem. And then that was increasingly a problem. So you go to Embu, you remember there was an intern in the governor's office. You go to Taita Taveta, there was an intern in the governor's office. You go to Nyeri, there was an intern in the governor's office. All these young ladies were being criminalized for saying there were certain wrong things happening in those areas. And the prosecution was quite happy to fast track those cases. But in others, they keep telling you we are investigating. So we thought we need to work on laws and policies so that even as we begin to think about the control and regulations around the digital space, our laws permit freedom of expression and access to information. But we've also supported processes of multi-stakeholder groups thinking through what ought to be done. Because we've had a situation where techies tell me, we are not human rights people and we don't care about human rights and freedom. For us, we just want the internet. And I keep telling them that we need to work on human rights to secure the internet for you. Otherwise, it's not just something that is going to be there. How do we work around those? But we've also developed back to digital aid. We've also developed some thinking on how do we navigate. I've talked about the issue of what is the proper balance between data protection and freedom of expression. So when you think through this Angaza Empowerment Network petition against the judges, and Derek says he has phone call logs of judges to other people, and that is what he's using in a court of law, where did he get the call logs from? And who gave him permission to do that? Isn't there a process of ensuring that there is a court order in the event that Safaricom or Telkom or Liquid are going to offer your call logs? Because try and think, how many of us would still want to retain their phone if you discovered that all your SMSs, the ones you've written sometimes half asleep in your bed, can be read by a person you didn't intend? Then you notice it's a challenge. All of us want to be publishers, but how many of us would like to publish a book about our SMSs? Yeah? So if your SMSs are just going to be there in a court petition, isn't that a problem? Don't we need to think through that? Then as an organization, we are trying to harmonize that thinking. Then next is an issue about protection. And within protection, our argument, even as I've said, yes, we need to help journalists and media workers to better understand how to assess their risks and develop mitigation strategies. You know, I saw yesterday there are journalists going to cover the protests, but they are in high heels and miniskirts. And I say clearly, this person did not know what they were going to cover. Yeah, but I've also seen people going to cover fire in Sinai, Yeah, and you see this journal is close to fire. This is oil that has spilled and is burning. But the journalist is struggling to take a close-up picture of the person who is burning, assuming that they can't be burned. So then what happens? Or a police officer has run mad, is beating children for protesting land grab on Lang'ata Road. But the journalist is feeling that this police officer, even as he beats children, on seeing you as a journalist, he will hold back because you are a journalist. Then I have a feeling that this journalist has not done any risk assessment. Yeah? Because if this police officer is beating a child, then you know he will definitely crack your skull. What, how do you understand the risk and how do you deal with it? But also, how do we teach media houses on how to develop protocols, safety protocols? So yes, a journalist has been sent to cover Sinai fire. Are they prepared? Or were you in a matatu and you are just told, please, there is a fire in the pipeline, go there now. And so yes, you had better clothes and shoes in the office, but you had to run with your high heels to go to pipeline. So are there protocols? Then you noticed, I think recently after the declaration about presidential elections, Duncan Khaemba and team arrested in Kibera. Why? Because Duncan was putting on a safety jacket. Yes, so there are media houses that have safety jackets, but what does the police officer say? You need to be carrying the original license, even as we go to cover protests. So the truth is, if you carry your original certificate and they took it, how would you protect yourself? So how do we manage those realities and discussions? Then you notice police officers did not just want to arrest Khaemba because he didn't have a certificate. They wanted to arrest him so that there is no journalist covering what they were doing. But they were looking for an easy way of pushing him out. So what do we do to think through protection? So, and we need protection, we work on self-protection, we work on securing the media environment, but we also engage with state and international actors so that we can deal with the issue of impunity. In Kenya, you know an example, journalists John Gashi and others will know, Wallace Yeshere pushed from a building in Buruburu. He died on a wheelchair. He had won the case, but his payment didn't come through by the time he was died. We know of Francis Nyarui, journalist with exclusives. He's going to cover a story, and he tells his colleagues, I'm just out for lunch, I'll be back. He goes to meet up an OCPD. He's never seen after 10 days, find his body head and torso apart in some forest in Kisi. John Kitui, the first journalist of a small newspaper in Eldoret, covering about the disappearances of witnesses in ICC, he dies just outside his gate, getting home before he published the big story. So there's cases of impunity here. It's not something you can take for granted. What do we do to help journalists and other people to engage in better in this process? And then we have the civic space. So I began by saying I support protests. So you would know that we developed this strategy before the IBC protests. So no relationship that we knew this was coming. The only thing is that perhaps we had hindsight that protests will become a big issue. And so when you think through this process, we are developing standards on protest. We've developed some thinking around public participation and what it means, equality and non-discrimination. And we've kept telling each other that until Kenya, or countries like Kenya that are highly polarized and divided, develop a law on equality and non-discrimination, our efforts to deal with hate speech are futile.
So this country does not recognize that we are all equal. We pay lip service to equality and non-discrimination. But we seem now to be paying a lot of credence to the fight on hate speech. It's not going to happen. We need to find a proper balance of recognizing every human being for what they are. And so there is a thinking around public order management laws. You and me would know that in Kenya, especially in Nairobi, we have senior police officers who do not think that there can be a legal protest. Even though the constitution clearly indicates that we have a right to picket, demonstrate, and protest, for them, all protests are illegal. Remember, sometimes they've argued that protesters get into criminal acts. And I was recently asking, what did doctors do? If you remember the doctors' protest, whose kiosk did doctors break in before they were tear gassed? So it is very easy for some of us to say, oh, those are NASA supporters. They are always violent. But whose kiosk is doctors breaking for them to be tear gassed? Which cars are they vandalized for them to be tear gassed? Then you begin to notice that senior people like Japheth Koome in police have not read the constitution. Or if they've read it, they've refused to accept that it is operational. So we need to be able to think through public order management laws. We need to think through what do we do so that protests can become normal without the violence that ends up in many of them. But we also need to think through participation. I'm one of the people who continue to ask, yes, we've said women will be nominated, persons with disability will be nominated, youth will be nominated, and workers. Why have we put that nomination right in political parties? What is the reason? So that ODM, NASA, Jubilee are the ones nominating workers. You and me will know that in the last parliament, Oburu Odinga was the representative of workers. In this Senate, Beth Mugo is the representative of workers. What does that tell us about our processes? That the law seems very good and well intended, but how is it being operationalized? So this public participation, how do we get the women to be nominated to fill those slots? Are they the credible representative of women groups? How do we get persons with disability to be nominated? The moment we have no law and we just put that into political parties' laws, then we reinforce the problem. So we need to think through public participation and other processes. And so John talked about the starting point. When we began, we were in only three countries. Now we work in most of these countries actively, some not very active. In Seychelles, we haven't done much, apart from just being able to help the judiciary understand that the 2013 presidential petition decision that relied on a decision from Seychelles relied on a minority decision and not the decision of the court. So you have those ongoing challenges in all these countries. Some have done very well, some are problematic. And many partners have listed some I may not have listed, but the issue is to show that Article 19 seeks to work in partnership with many other people. You noticed, yes, we've grown from 3 to 10. We are not going to grow to 50 John. The design is we are lean, clean organization. So we will not grow to 50 because we are going to work into many other countries. We'll keep our focus and try to keep the process as neat as it can be. So those are lists of some of the partners are continuing. I've listed some of the Kenyan universities, but even as we do this meeting, we've established a partnership with a Norwegian university, which is currently supporting a workshop that is ongoing at Pan-African, bringing together journalists from 7 different countries on how to use access to information for investigative purposes. So briefly, that is the layout of our strategy. I've tried to make it basic so that
we don't get too much into the matrices that most people who are planners try to use. So I would perhaps, before moving to the next session, just allow people to make some interventions or questions. But if you're still framing or internalizing the presentation, we can as well take a bit of the case studies. There are also challenges, as John would say. There are times when my first meeting with the cabinet secretary, ICT in Kenya, was on a TV interview, and the only thing he knew about us was the organization that sues government. So he said, oh, Henry, you belong to that organization that sues government. I've been told that there are too many courts pending, cases pending in court. So I sat back and I said, is this the brief he got from his predecessor in the process?
My name is Richard Anyega. I support and communicate with finance and administration. Nimeitwa hapa kuongea juu ya wale wenye wametusukuma kufanya ile kazi ambayo imezungumziwa hapa leo. Na yangu itakuwa fupi tu kutaja majina ya wale donors wenye wametusupport kutoka wakati Article 19 East Africa ilianza kazi yake. Tumepata msaada mkubwa kutoka kwa wafuatao: the Baring and John Ellerman Foundation from the UK, the Department of Foreign and International Development, the UK government, National Endowment for Democracy, a trust based in the US, Denmark Development Corporation, Canadian High Commission, the Swedish International Development Cooperation Agency, Deutsche Welle Academy, which is a German press organization, the German Enterprise for International Cooperation, normally known as GIZ, the European Commission, HIVO's people, both internationally and the local office, the Open Society Initiative for Eastern Africa, the Ford Foundation, the US-based foundation, Hewlett-Packard, normally known as HP. We've also received support from a UK trust called Prisoners of Conscience, which has been supporting journalists that require emergency support and those that are exiled in various countries across East Africa. The Dutch government through the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the US State Department, Konrad Adenauer Stiftung, the German word, so maybe I might not spell it or pronounce it correctly, UNESCO, Africa Freedom of Information Center, AFIC, which is based in Uganda, and Henry Miner, the director of Article 19, happens to be a member of the group. Article 19 International, which Paddy heads as the board chairman, has been our greatest support and continue supporting our core activities as we run the Eastern Africa Article 19 office. And there are many others, including the Norwegian Press Association, which is currently, as Henry has mentioned earlier on, that is sponsoring our access to information training currently being held at the Pan-African Hotel. And there are many others in very small and bigger ways that have supported the activities Article 19 have been running. And we are very grateful, especially to Paddy and the International Office. We're very thankful for helping us with the core activities that we continue with the Eastern African Office. Thank you.
We are just not an elite entity that sits in town and feels good. You know, there's some work that has been ongoing. And for me, it's very relieving. The stories I hear, you know, when Saget and team
were leaving jail, the understanding was that the newspaper they ran on radio would not survive again. And so being able to help her to start a new newspaper and come back onto her feet is something that I feel proud about, and I encourage other people not to give up. Saidet is quite an exemplary professional and mother at it. She remained more positive than most of us who are dealing with her situation, because you can guess she's elderly, she had children in another country, and no support system in the country. But whenever you visited her, you came out feeling that there is need to fight more, because she's willing to keep the fight. And I appreciate all those earlier colleagues. You notice she mentioned Stephanie and Victor in her presentation. So Stephanie didn't want to say she is our former staff, but we don't regret her. She needs to have a new identity. But we know that we are tied to each other. So we appreciate those efforts and the struggle that happened, knowing that ours was the first ever submission to their court to seek in to be an interested party. Their courts had never entertained such. They didn't know what to do. They adjourned, and after a week or so, came back and said, "We hear what you are saying, but we can't admit you." So charting new processes. So Ben and team, you know, there are those of us who now think being an amicus or being an interested party in Kenya, we've taken it for granted. But there are colleagues in the region where that is not the norm. And we need to just keep helping move the process. But the challenge in Rwanda is perhaps a challenge we are going to see here, where you have those crowded charge sheets. You know, you are sued with genocide denial, then you are sued with criminal defamation. And you know, so that if you jump over one hoop, they get you into the other. And at the tail end of their case, they were not found guilty on genocide denial. But you can guess, because it's not bailable, you have gone through very humiliating situations. Even when they are quitting you, that's not enough to restore you to where you are. So that's our story. Happy now to get any comments. Happy to get any people who are happy to say, "Henry, I'm just giving you a blank check. Go and fill in. Go and fill in what, how much money you want, because you're doing a great job." Or this is how you can also raise money. You know, I need to learn from Jim how I can just get this money. You know, so apart from him benefiting from our side, I think there are lessons we've learned that Kenyans of goodwill out there are willing to support genuine causes if asked, and if you're going to be accountable to them.
I am Maslin Nambala. I'm the Executive Director, Association of Media Women in Kenya. We are proud to have partnered with Article 19 in looking at the online security of women journalists. And the publications are, I saw several copies still. And this is work that we have gone ahead to do. And I know that Henry has repeatedly told me the case of Jacqueline Okuta. And today I'm glad to meet you. I'm extremely touched by your story. And I think going forward, we will be picking up on that and on how, because so many women journalists, like you say, face the threat. And like the kind of studies we are still undertaking, how women express themselves online. And not just women journalists, women generally, considering the mobile phone penetration and how expressive women are, you know, the words they throw generally, and now that online space is available for them, that they might go there and express themselves and the consequences. And it's very clear, the case is very clear to me. Kulkat Marina, my good friend whom we worked together at the Standard, I also had a stint in investigative journalism under Douglas Okwach, and I think, and so I'm really touched, and I pray that your case goes well. Thank you so much. Just to also say, I'm saddened that criminals are walking free while innocent, well-meaning Kenyans are the ones who are being arrested. And I want to say that we were unfortunate with our offices, we had a burglary. And the way the police handled these issues is not with the kind of professionalism and enthusiasm that I'm seeing being expressed on people who are innocent. So it is sad that that is where we are as a nation. And I like the aspect also about freedom of information, because we also do work in reproductive health. And there are times when maybe there's a strike and there's only one doctor with so many women giving birth. And randomly we need to access information on some of the information with regard to our health, the movement of drugs. So we talk about freedom of information. Again, Kulkat will tell you, I also had a stint as an environment journalist, and I had the opportunity to say, we are going to have clean water by the year 2000 running in every household. Unfortunately, today is the opposite. You know that actually, in many estates, water will not run in your tap. You have to go and collect it somewhere. And so we really need to go and say, what kind of data do we require from the government? When our water just flows into the Indian Ocean. So this kind of access to information that can help us generate information that can help policy and that can help us solve a lot of things. In refer to the SDGs, we did a lot of work on MDGs, and now we are also looking to do work on SDGs that we can take to the grassroots. For us, we have a lot of grassroots engagement with our radio listening groups. Finally, we do not have our litigation department, but we still have a lot of cases. And we are hoping that our partnership with Article 19 will extend, that Article 19 can help us litigate one of the sexual harassment cases against the women, and that we can have some groundbreaking work there. Thank you very much, Henry.
Good afternoon and hello to everyone. Hello John, hello Paddy, hello everybody.
Welcome back.
Thank you. I'm Stephanie. I am now an amicus to Article 19. Previously a baby of Article 19, had a great time and experience. Congratulations to everyone at Article 19 for the great achievements over the 10 years. Mine will be brief, it's just an encouragement for the next 10. And I will take my lesson from Twitter. How many of us are on Twitter? Have you seen the storm about the 280 characters? Yes. So for those of you who are not on Twitter, I guess the joy of Twitter is you have to say things in 140 characters, and you have to be very brief and concise. And now the makers of Twitter want to add the characters to about 280. And most of us are not having that on Twitter, and we're making it known as if it's our product. But we're letting Twitter know that its niche is important, and that's what that was its value add and is its value add. And so I'd like to say to Article 19, over the next 10 years, there's a big temptation to change and do things differently, and you know, all of these things, and people are having the pressure to recreate themselves. I would like to say, keep doing what you're doing. It's a very important niche in an area that Article 19 is doing. I think if we all do our one thing well in this world, we make a difference. So by all means, innovate, use new methods, do everything that you want to do, but keep doing Article 19 and keep doing it well, and we will continue to see even greater leaps in the next 10 years. So congratulations.
They say that I and Patrick Mutai had invited Ethiopian security to abduct him, you know, done this year. So it was under Article 19 that we were able to mobilize funds, and then we were able to repatriate the body after a week, and for it to be buried there. Perhaps the other thing I would like to quickly mention is that in terms of safety and security of journalists, Article 19 has been at the forefront. In fact, in terms of documentation and even publication of material, media, as I said, is extremely weak, has no capacity. So sometimes we depend on Article 19 in terms of documenting cases. We can complement what they are doing, but now we depend on their documentation when it comes to, you know, what they are looking at, in terms of who is violated within the media sector, the safety and security of journalists. And then the last thing I would like to say, of course, by no means the least, is that Article 19's work is important in this region. I've worked in, I think, the countries that Article 19 is covering currently. For the last 6 years, I've been working in those countries under different framework, except Madagascar. And if you go there, they need the kind of interventions that Article 19 needs. So I think this is an important work, and getting the testimonies from our colleagues from Rwanda lately, and of course the others who have had interventions locally, you can see how important Article 19 is. So I want to encourage you, as you go to the next year, that this is an important engagement. Please take it up. We wish you well, and from our KC point of view, I think we value you as an important partner for the industry.
I wish especially to appreciate the CAJ, because as the ombudsman, they are the main institution cited for oversight and enforcement within the Access Information Act. So they've been very open to discussions with Article 19 as to how to move this forward, how to work together, how to build capacity both ways, just to see that access information implementation is where it's at and actually has an impact in terms of enhancing accountability and transparency. Ben from Katiba, thanks for all the support we've given each other all through whatever we are discussing now in terms of how to, you know, make processes easier for Kenyans to ask for information, how to enhance oversight and all that. I think one of the things I'm encouraged about is that we've been able to get people from different sectors thinking about how access to information works for them. And I think that is something that we definitely would like to build on, enhancing the constituency of access to information advocates, so that it's not just us who are working on access to information who are like, we see the utility and the instrumentality, but everybody working in every sector. So Haki Jamii with their water and health, those who are working in social accountability. I'm happy to see extractive sector and environmental sector here. Literally, access to information touches on everything. And so it's a challenge to everybody here that access to information is actually also your business. So thank you very much. I do beg to leave, but I'm sure other deliberations will go on, will be fruitful. And so thank you very much for making time to mark this. And as people have kept on reiterating, let's make the next 10 years even better, bigger and better. So thank you very much.
I'm happy to use our skills, my experience in criminal justice system over the years and now in freedom of expression to see how we can frame the cases. But I can't say I'm the leader on that, because it would require me doing lots of reading, which sometimes I don't have the time to anymore. So I think the best way to move forward is that we need to have sessions, Muslim, to think through, is litigation the best option? Because sometimes I think we all think litigation is the solution, but sometimes it's not. So we need to ask which is the best case for litigation, but what do we do with the current case if litigation is not the best option? You know, because you can get into the system and you are stuck in there for many years. And for the people involved, they might not understand, why didn't you tell us all this, that it was going to take me too long? You had Kurigat saying, he was told, we will push this case to the highest level. But as the case unfolds, he begins to see that they are saying, you will pay 50%. And the case goes on and goes on and goes on. And so it has very sometimes
debilitating effect on the individual. So litigation is an appropriate strategy, but we ought to think through it as much. In terms of, I think, for Collins on water and others, we've already begun the process. So if you are working on the tables far end, you would see we have free flow principles, which is already telling people we're beginning to ask what is the normative thinking around right to water, especially if you live in estates where there is no water on the taps. You know, what is the minimum that you should expect? Growing up in Iceland, we used to have a communal water point. So we never had water meters for every house. But nowadays, there are meters for everyone, but no water. What does that say? And yet, there are more private vendors who tend to know when there is no water. So where do they get their water from? You know, and there's a whole licensing regime around water. So for water, I think we've done some work, and we can happily begin moving the process forward. For other health issues, we are in court supporting another group on the idea of lack of information on abortion guidelines, which were with the DROM. So helping people who work on sexual and reproductive rights to see the connection with information and the many deaths that women are being forced to go through because of procuring unwanted abortion. And how do we begin to manage that bad situation so that as a country we can secure their right, reproductive rights. So Tracy, I want you to perhaps prepare to make some announcement where people will have lunch. But once again, it's just to appreciate those who've come to walk this journey with us. We know it takes a toll on you sometimes on the demands you keep making. And those who've come in contact with Henry, you know that my demands are very forceful sometimes. So appreciate that you have withstood that kind of challenge. But you also know that I'm extremely candid. If I'm your partner, I'm in it till death do us part. So you can count on me. I'm not one of those people who will run away because they are threats. I'm fit to die if I must for rights. So let's keep holding each other by hand. Use this opportunity to interact with more people, to get to know what the other colleague is doing and how you can partner. Begin to see how Jackson Jeru is able to help Jacqueline even before they had physically met. Telling you that if you have that humanity kind of endeavor, you can help not only people who are around you, but those who are just in need of that assistance and you have the capacity.